Okay.
Force, perfect.
Perfect. Okay, so let's start. Welcome to the July edition of the BERS seminar at the National Bank of Romania. Usually we had this seminar in the last Thursday of the month. We scheduled it a bit earlier, also because tomorrow we have in Sibiu a starting conference that many of you know about, ERMAS conference of Romanian academics from abroad presenting their research, and Maria is also presenting there. We know Maria since 2011, I think.
Yes.
When you had an internship in our department, the modeling and forecasting department, the paper you developed while having the internship, I think, earned a prize.
The Costin Murgescu work,
right.
First edition.
Yeah, that's good. It's still there, and Mr. Dismărescu, the 2011 head of the deposit guarantee fund, sends his best regard to you and asks us to say hi. So we have Maria Bulbaca today. Maria is a postdoc researcher and lecturer at the University of St. Gallen Institute of Economics. The PhD, sorry, is from University of Bern with titled of the thesis Essays on Productivity, Technological Change and Economic Fluctuations. She had the master from the same university together with the Basel University and the BA from the Bucharest University of Economic Studies, visiting position up to now with the National Bank of Poland and the Toulouse School of Economics. The up-to-date research is centered around the impact of technological change, human capital, and news diffusion. And the paper we are going to see today, co-authored with Guido Gozzi and Silvia Galli, it's Multinationals Entry, Boon or Bane for Non-Frontier Economies. Thank you, Maria, for accepting our invitations. And thanks for being here today.
Thanks a lot, Mihai, for the nice introduction and for the invitation, which for me was a personal celebration of this 10 years time since I did the internship in your department. And it was a great experience writing my research project with your help and the help of Slava Grigoraș, which is a great researcher as well. And I am very grateful for your help in that project, which, as you said, won the award and in fact was a very important factor in the decision of the university to grant me access in the PhD program and for being hired at the study center Gerzense, where I had the chance to meet even more of the people from the National Bank of Romania. Some of them maybe would join today's session or see my presentation afterwards. So thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here presenting you one of my latest projects, as you said, with Guido Cozzi and Silvia Galli, both of them my colleagues at the University of St. Gallen. So to jump into the presentation, I would first want to say that whenever there is a question, please interrupt me with voice, because due to the full screen options and these technical issues, I don't see the raise hands option. So just interrupt me whenever there is the need for clarifications and so on and so forth. So just stop me, please, when you have we have a question. Okay, so from the title comes the research question of this paper. So practically what we would like to see is whether multinationals' entry into a non-frontier economy is a boon or a bane. And this comes from something that we often hear in the news. We see politicians discussing, both in good times and in bad times, this role of multinationals, with some arguing that they are great for the economies, that they will enhance the economy's growth, while others are supporting the ideas that they are not, they are a bane for the economy, that they are leading to high volatility of output, and they create more trouble than bringing benefits. So given this debate and having as well a lot of contradicting evidence in terms of empirics, what we are trying to do in this paper is to come up with a macroeconomic model that is able to account for the role of multinational corporations, and I will refer to them throughout the presentation as MNCs for abbreviation. So a model that can account for the role of MNCs, Zentry, in driving economic fluctuations, both at high and low frequency. This meaning their effect not only on the growth of the economy, so their effect in the long run, but also their effect in the short run at business cycle frequencies. And this is, to the best of our knowledge, one of the first approach, I'm not sure if there is a question. Okay, there was a microphone open somewhere. So it's one of, it's the first approach to the best of our knowledge of addressing this problem, as I said, high and low frequency in a non-frontier small open economy. And what we mean by non-frontier is an economy that is not yet at the frontier of technology. Okay, so this is motivated by the case of Central and Southeastern European countries. And as you have already, if not seen from the beginning of the talk, but from the name at least, I am Romanian, so I'm personally interested in the topic. So these countries, which are members of the European Union, some of them from 2004, 2007, and so forth. So these countries, these 11 countries, which I will call the CSEE countries, namely Bulgaria, Croatia, Czech Republic, Estonia, Hungary, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, Romania, Slovak Republic, and Slovenia, have the particularity of entering a process of catching up with Western Europe starting in the mid-90s. And in this period, so starting from the from mid-90s to the start, to the onset of the pandemic, actually, they have recorded a strong economic growth as a group. And at the same time, strong productivity gains, which were accompanied by large foreign direct investment, henceforth FDI inflows. And this happened in the absence of considerable improvement in domestic innovation. And I will show you some figures to actually convince you that that I am right about this statement. Okay, so what we can see if we look at the data is that between 95 and 2019, FDI inflows in the CSE region have averaged about 4.15% of GDP, which is actually double than the world average. And it's higher not only than in the Western Europe, so the EU 15 countries, as they are often referred to, but also than in both developing countries, DCs, or other emerging markets. As this group, it's often referred as being emerging markets. Okay, so the CSEE as a group have received more FDI inflows than all the others groups that I took here for a comparison. And this picture, it's actually displaying what I was just saying in terms of averages. So the blue circled line that appears in all three plots is this average inward FDI flows as a percentage of the of GDP over the period 1995-2019 in the group of CSEE countries. Okay, and what we see in the top graph is the comparison with the same variable, average inward FDI flows, in the EU15. And we see with some few exceptions that we have a higher share, so a higher FDI flows as a percentage of GDP in this group of countries compared to the group of EU15. Okay, and in particular, we have we observed the biggest gap between these two in the period, starting with the addition of a big group of a big part of these countries to the European Union in 2004. Okay, and the gap has been narrowing and has been stayed narrower from the beginning of the Great Recession. However, we can see that in the past couple of years, before the start of the pandemic, and we don't have data available from 2020, so we actually can see only till the end of 2019, we see that again inward FDI flows would be higher than in the CSE, would be higher than in the EU15. And similarly, as I said, when we compare with the G7 countries, the whole world put together, or when we take the comparison with in the bottom panel with the emerging market group or the developing countries. So no matter which group of countries we take, we observe higher FDI flows into the CSEE group as a percentage of their GDP. Okay. It's a strong discussion in the literature is that usually countries that grow faster, countries that are developing, that are in particular emerging markets, are experiencing net outflows, net capital outflows, and not inflows. However, while this may be the case when we look at emerging markets in general, developing countries, this is not the case for the group of CSEE countries for this time span that we are looking at. So in this plot, with blue, I am displaying FDI inward flows with the straight line with the circles, and the dotted line is FDI outward flows, so the outflows of FDI, and we observe that throughout this period we have more inflows in the CSEE region than outflows. Okay, so this in fact shows the attractiveness of the region throughout this whole period that we are considering. No matter in which phase of the economy we are, so not even in the period of the Great Recession or in the sovereign debt crisis, the European sovereign debt crisis, we are not observing a change in this pattern. So we have more inflows than outflows throughout the whole period. And considering the vertical axis on the right side, we have with orange the FDI inward stocks, and we observe how much the stock has been increasing over time. It's a considerable increase, okay, throughout this period. Even though, as we observe from the slowdown in inflows, also that the stocks seem to have plateaued for a while. Okay. As I said, the idea is that these countries that are growing faster experience these developing or emerging countries, more specific in this case, should experience more capital outflows than inflows. But what we have is not that. Okay, these countries, as I said at the beginning, they were growing fast in this period, both if we look at their GDP growth. Okay, there again, I use the blue line for the group of CSE countries, and we observe higher GDP growth throughout big parts of this sample period that we cover in the discussion. Of course, with one of the big exceptions when we have a massive drop in the in GDP growth in the period of recession, in the Great Recession. And similarly, if we look at productivity growth, at TFP growth in these two regions that we are comparing here, we again see a similar picture, right? So we have higher productivity growth in the CSE region than in the EU 15 group of countries. Okay, of course, we may think that we don't have any reason to think about causality. I just said this region had experienced large capital inflows and at the same time experienced strong growth in both productivity and output, but that doesn't need to be the case that FDI is responsible for this growth, right? It could be that there is a lot of research and development in the area, and this is what determines the increase in productivity. However, when we look at the data for research and development and in the area, it becomes apparent the fact that this is not the case. So domestic innovation does not seem to be much accountable for this great economic performance that started in the mid-90s in this region. So if you look at the numbers, we see that gross domestic expenditure on R&D in the CSE region has been significantly lower than in the average European country. For example, we can see that there was less than 1% of GDP invested in R&D in the CSE and about 2% in EU 15. We did a bit of a simple cross-correlation computation between the growth rates of TFP and R&D expenditure, and we could not find any evidence in favor of a lead lag effect. Of course, it's simplistic, very simple exercise. However, when we did the same exercise, we did find a positive cross-correlation between inward FDI flows and different measures of productivity. There is empirical evidence that is doing, so of course, exercises that are more complex than our computation of cross-correlations, but there is mixed results, okay? So mixed opinions, and of course, and obviously, the results are depending on the econometric approach followed, the countries that are considered in the exercise, the specific data included, time span, and so on and so forth. However, from our observation, from our reading of the literature, more recent studies that go in more granular data, so having firm level data, industry data, they do tend to favor this idea that there is a positive externality of FDI on domestic productivity. That being said, I would like you to take this piece of information as a motivation for what we are doing. So in this paper, we are not going to do an empirical exercise. We are not going to work with data. We just take this observation and we want to see one theoretical model, but taken into a quantitative exercise, can tell us. Okay, so what we do in order to investigate whether and to what extent MNC's entry and R&D, so which of the two are more or less sources of economic fluctuations and technological progress in non-frontier economies, what we do in this paper is to propose a dynamic stochastic general equilibrium model, short DSG model, for a small open economy, and we enrich it with endogenous adoption of an exogenously evolving technological frontier that is developed abroad, in order to do exactly what I said at the beginning, that we want to see the role of MNCs both in the short and the medium run. Okay, and by putting these two together, the DSG with this growth component, this endogenous growth part, we are able to answer our research question. So just to put it short, the key elements of this model is that it's let's call it medium-sized DSG model, only with real rigidities. And this is something we did for simplicity. We could extend it and add nominal rigidities, but that will complicate our estimation, okay? Because we will have due to the changes in monetary policy, we will have to shorten the time span that we cover with the data. Our model describes a small open economy. So we are, as I said, we are trying to keep it as the model as small as possible, but to put the key elements that will help us answer our questions. And here is where the more complex part comes, is in the fact that we are introducing this endogenous Schumpeterian creative destruction growth engine. And I will come back to that in some minutes. Our approach is based on the fact that we are considering that in this economy there is an adaptation of the world technological frontier. So our economy that we are going to look at today is not an economy which is able to influence the world technological frontier. Okay, the only thing that can happen is this in this economy is that domestic firms, through their investment in research and development, they can try to adapt the world technological frontier. They can make small steps towards the frontier. Okay, at the same time, what we have in this model is the possibility of multinationals to entry. And the difference between the domestic firms and the multinationals is that the multinational bring the frontier technology. They come from more advanced economies and they have the possibility to bring the frontier technology in this economy. Of course, this happens at the expense of the domestic firms in the sector. And because some of the domestic firms will become obsolete, they will be replaced by these more advanced firms, there would be a reallocation of resources in this economy, and this will be growth enhancing. So we are practically going to look at these two channels. Okay, and what this will imply for the domestic economy. What we are going to do in order to have a quantitative analysis, we will take data for Hungary, and we will use it to estimate the model. Why we choose Hungary out of those 11 that I was enumerating a few minutes ago? We didn't have a particular reason. I might have been the only one in this group of authors who might have had a reason to choose Romania. But for Hungary, we found a lot of data available. It was also the political discussion with the Orban administration and the political views regarding multinationals. Secondly, and thirdly, Hungary, in the whole group of countries in the CSEE region, have the largest share of multinational companies in the economy, and they represent about 50% of the business sector. Okay,
so I have some questions, Maria, just before going forward. Yeah. One is related to the idea of having nominal rigidities in the model. In the group you mentioned, in the group of countries you mentioned at the beginning, the 11 Central mm-hmm. and Southeastern European countries, I think there are differences in terms of the, I mean, there are differences even inside this group based on the monetary policy regime they have. So if you compare the inflation targeting versus the fixed exchange currency board, you see higher growth, I think prior to the crisis, or lower volatility in the business cycle in those with flexible exchange rates, higher current account and higher impact of the crisis in 2009 for those with a fixed exchange rate. So there might be some value added in looking also in the nominal part, if you want to go a bit forward. And the second question refers to the mechanism you describe here. Maybe I'm just jumping forward a bit, but do you have, I mean, in your model, is the non-frontier emerging economy converging for sure, or can it get stuck at some point in like diverging from the developed one? Did you look at this, or like, do you have something on this?
No, I mean, we haven't thought of looking on this, if it's converging or not. I think this would be an exercise of a purely growth model. And this is being a very long-term discussion of convergence, non-convergence. However, I mean, here, by having the multinationals entry, you do have a convergence, given that you are with the multinationals entry, you are bringing the frontier technologies in the country and they represent a share of the domestic economy. You are much faster converging with their help than through domestic innovation, which, as you will see in a couple of minutes in the model, is a bit slower, will make the productivity of this non-frontier economy converge slower, given that they are not as capable of reaching the frontier as are the multinationals. And this is, we try to make a realistic assumption based on the stylized facts that I just showed you.
Because I'm thinking of these models of leapfrogging, you have, I don't know, Krugman.
Yeah, that's a purely growth world, okay, where we will have a deterministic model. We start in a steady state and we are ending in another steady state. And due to some policy change, we will observe this transition from one to the other. While here, what we are doing is to bring a bit of that idea into a DSGE. And what this helps us to do is, in fact, to allow temporary shocks the possibility. And this is one of the big value added to the literature of these models that have a DSG component and a growth component, that they can allow to temporary shocks the possibility to have longer run effects or more persistent effects without the unrealistic assumption that you have very persistent shocks. When going to, you had also the other question with the differences in the countries. Of course, there are big differences in these countries. And we are just looking at this point at their common feature, that they were countries going from, most of them, or the group was going from a more communist regime to an open market setup, and they did experience a lot of FDI inflows through the policies that were taken in these countries, to their openness to capital, of their markets to capital flows. I am convinced that, and we had an attempt of a version of this model with nominal rigidities, but as I told you, we were earlier, we were losing part of the data. And as you will see in some moments, when we reached the estimation part, we also have some annual data. So it would have been, this makes harder the estimation. But we might think of doing this this extension by having this comparison of costs and then benefits at some point in the paper. But yeah, I will show you that even without these nominal rigidities, I think the model is able to say to answer our research question. Okay, so I won't spend too much time on the literature. I also find it boring when when people take half of their presentation to discuss other people's work. I already said when answering Mihai's question about something about the literature on which we are developing, and this is this novel literature that stems from Comin and Gertler's seminal work, the Medium Cycle paper, AER paper from 2006. In which productivity growth is endogenized in a DSG framework. And as I told you, there are a lot of papers being written developing on this idea, in particular to after having this very slow recovery following the Great Recessions, the Great Recession, when economists needed a way to allow, as I said, to temporary shocks, the possibility to have more persistent effects without an unrealistic assumption on their persistence. Okay, so here it happens through this growth mechanism, endogenous growth mechanism. However, a big part of this literature works on closed economies. There are a few exceptions that are looking at open economies. Nevertheless, we are considering that, to the best of our knowledge, that we have the first paper that has this setup of a small open economy that is exposed to multinationals' entry, and which is not able to affect the world technological frontier, but still agents of the firms in this economy have this research and development activity in through which they try to adapt the frontier to their local circumstances. Okay, and this, this we think is the case of so many countries. So it's important to bring a model that can also discuss their particularities. Okay, so through this paper, we believe that we are filling a gap in this particular literature. Of course, with what we do here, we are connecting to other literatures. One of them is the literature that analyzes the role played by capital flows in driving either business cycles or growth. And as I said before, following this seminal work of Gorinchas and Jean, where they show what I said, the fact that slow growing countries, usually richer countries, have higher capital flows, while less faster growing, usually poorer countries, have have net capital outflows. There have been extensive work done on each of these topics. Okay, so some are working on the case of Southern Europe, This is the case of the surge of in capital inflows in the early 2000s and their effect on resource allocation. Others are looking at the case of capital outflows from emerging markets and how they are contributing to global imbalances, the slowdown in frontier productivity. But as we have seen before, our particular case of the CSEE countries is not in any of these two groups. Okay, so we have growing economies that had net capital inflows in the period. Okay, of course, is there a question? Okay, there are. All other literatures we are connecting, lots of papers being written on capital flows in general, less on FDI flows in particular. The research that is done on FDI flows is not done in this particular setup of a DSG with endogenous growth. So they are usually different type of models. Of course, with our quantitative analysis of the application of our model, so taking our model to the data, we can also discuss, we can also contribute to the discussion of what are the shocks that drive economic fluctuations in emerging markets. And there are different papers with different approaches that do find an important role for foreign shocks in driving economic activity in these emerging economies. So with our approach to study this interplay between MNCs entry and domestic R&D in driving the productivity in non-frontier economies, we believe we are contributing also to this literature. Okay, just to a small hint to what we are finding in this paper before getting to the results section. What our results are indicating is that in this particular case of Hungary, we find that MNC's entry has proved to be both boon and bane for the Hungarian economy. On one side, it has positively impacted economic growth, but at the same time, it had led to an amplification of business cycles in this period. So there was an accentuation of both the booms and but also of the recessions due to multinationals' activity. However, when we look at the role of research and development in this economy, we find that research and development subsidies provided by the government to the businesses in Hungary have had an insignificant role in driving productivity and output growth, regardless at the horizon at which we are looking, so both in the short and the medium run. Okay, so I will go into the model. I will focus mostly on the elements that we consider are more particular, so what are the novelty that we are bringing. I will say some few words about the calibration, briefly going into the estimation approach, and then we are going to see and discuss the results before concluding. Okay, the setup, before looking at equations, is the following. So we have the economy of a small open economy, which is populated by households, goods producers, we have domestic innovators, the multinationals, and the government. The household is as simple as possible. So we have identical households. So one representative agent who consumes the final good, invests in both capital and R&D, supplies labor services, and supplies labor services to the producing firms. Manufacturing is done in two sectors, and this is the standard DSG idea of having a final goods producer that is aggregating the output of intermediate goods producers who are producing monopolistically. So final goods producers are operating in a competitive fashion, while at the intermediate good level, we have monopolistic competition. And as I said, the interesting part comes when we go into the innovation section, so how technology, how productivity evolves in this economy. And here we have domestic innovators who are using the R&D investment that is provided by the households, and they use it to fill to produce a probability of filling the gap between their sectorial productivity and the frontier. But as I said, they are not able to target the frontier. They are targeting an intermediate technological level. Once they have, so each period we have these steps. So first we let the innovator make its step. And then we are allowing the multinational firms to enter. So the multinationals are equipped with the frontier technology, and they enter the sector with an endogenous probability that depends on their investment, which is which we are matching with FDI. Okay, the government is very simple in this setup. So what the government is doing here, it has the only purpose of partially funding the R&D expenditures of innovators. So they tax the households, but we have lump sum taxes for this purpose, and they provide subsidies for R&D to the innovators. Okay, as I said, I won't spend time on the manufacturing section because it's very standard. Okay, we have this unique final good that is produced by these perfectly competitive firms. They combine this continuum of intermediate goods according to constant returns to scale production. And as I just said, the intermediate goods are produced under monopolistic competition. And we have here both capital and labor. So they use both capital and labor as inputs in the production, in the standard Cobb-Douglas production function. At the level of the households, as I said, we have identical households, each maximizing its utility function. We do have a standard constant relative risk aversion utility function with the only addition, it may look funny to some of you for the reason that it appears this S here, because the household is able to choose consumption spending, C, labor supplied, L. Okay, but appears also this term S here, which is a geometric average of current and past habit adjusted consumption levels according to this function. And what is this more precisely? It's a preference specification attributed to Jaimovic and Rebello, which has the nice feature that depending on the value of chi here, you may have you can allow for two extremely different preference specifications. So when you have chi equal to one, you have you are practically having the strongest wealth effect on labor, and you have the specification of the preferences of King, Plosser, and Rebello. And at the other extreme, if you have chi equal to zero, you are in the other extreme case of the preferences of Greenwood, Herkovitz and Hoffman, I think it's the GHH. So you have this, the possibility of these two extreme preferences and everything in between, being that chi can be between 0 and 1. And what we, why we did this, it was because we wanted to estimate this parameter and not impose a particular specification for this wealth effect on labor. So we just wanted to have it here and estimate it. And we haven't seen it in any of the papers that combine the SGEs with endogenous growth. So we think it's another contribution to this particular model setup, because our estimation gives a pretty far estimator from the starting, so to the from the prior. So I think it's a clear indicator of what our model setup prefers.
I have a question here. Yes. Just maybe anticipating again, how would you identify that parameter while trying to estimate also the risk aversion parameter, or also calibrating probably the labor part parameter, the theta? No? Is it possible? What would you have to put as observed variable?
Putting as observables, to me, an indicator that it is identified, but you can contradict me if I'm wrong. I'm not the best the expert in estimation. So to me, an indicator was the fact that it was moving from away from the prior. So it really shows, and no matter if we were adding something or taking out in terms of observables, we were getting in the same direction. So we start, as you will see in some minutes, with a prior centered at 0.5. And it went no matter what in the direction of 1.
Okay, but you are estimating also sigma?
No.
Okay, We are
estimating the habit persistent parameter only.
Okay.
But sigma, no. And also, we are not estimating theta, so...
Yeah, that was my question. So how can you identify...
No, we are not...
Among the three of them, so you are not estimating two, and you are basically getting the third one.
What we did, and it will become clearer once we reach the calibration and estimation part, what we tried to do at that point when deciding what to calibrate and what to estimate was to use as much information that we had and calibrate those parameters for which we were more or less sure of what they should be, but then estimate those for which we had no clue where we should position. From these parameters that we have so far on this slide, we are only estimated the habit persistence parameter for consumption and this this elasticity chi here. Okay, so in terms of budget constraint, what the household receives and has to spend income on, we have on the right side what the household receives, and in particular the household gets income for the labor it supplies, gets profits from the firms owned, and we have here what will be soon clearer, this F share, which is the share of foreign firms in the economy. So the households receive dividends for the firms that they are owning, but not for those that are multinationals, and in which case the dividends are going abroad. And they also receive the interest for the foreign bonds. We only have foreign bonds, so we don't have domestic and foreign bonds. There are only foreign bonds, and we have this perfect technology that in this economy they can also issue these foreign bonds. Of course, this is a simplifying assumption, and there could be we could also have both foreign and domestic, and then have also exchange rate and adding and then trade. Obviously, there are lots of complications and extensions of the model that could be. As I said, so far we are trying just to look at these multinationals versus domestic innovators part. Okay, and the household spend the income on consumption, physical capital investment, a part of the R&D investment that is not funded by the government, because we just said that they are the ones, the households are the ones that are investing into research and development, and then there is this the part that they are paying for taxes, lump sum taxes, and they are deciding on the acquisition of bonds, foreign bonds. Pretty simple. We have the law of motion of physical capital in a standard fashion. We are introducing some shocks. So here we have the a shock on non-investments, the margin efficiency of investment shocks. These are introduced for the main reason of having as many shocks as observable in the model. And we will, as we will see in some minutes, estimate the parameters defining this exogenous processes. We have here one another rigidity. We had before seen that we are introducing heavy persistence in consumption, and here we are introducing adjustment costs to investment. So we will have the standard definition of adjustment cost to investment, and we are going to then apply it to all the other sorts of investment for the sake of symmetry. Now we are going into the more interesting part of the paper. So, as I said, we have the world technological frontier evolving exogenously. Our small open economy has no way of influencing this. We define this variable as AT max, and we are letting it fluctuate around a constant rate with an exogenous process. So it's fluctuating around this this mean value gx0 exogenously. Okay, for the main reason that, as I said, our economy is not able to influence it, and we are thinking about it as being, let's say, the case of the US level of productivity. So you will see in an instant that in the estimation part, we will use the TFP, the evolution of TFP in the US, as a proxy for the evolution of the frontier technology as seen by our domestic economy, our small open economy. What the domestic innovators are doing is attempting to fill the gap in each sector, by targeting an intermediate level. And why we are making this assumption is, as I said, because we have seen that these economies in the CSE region are not performing that well in terms of R&D. And this has been also common knowledge, so it was not realistic to assume that whenever there is innovation, these economies are generating the frontier technology. They may reach the level of producing frontier technology, because that would be the case in this expression here, when we will have phi t minus 1 equal to 1. And this depends on the, this function is giving us the speed of convergence. And we are assuming here that the countries that are closer to the frontier, they are converging faster. The further the country is in terms of its productivity from the frontier, the harder it is to get there. Which again, if you have a rudimentary technology in your country, it's much harder to be able to produce frontier technology. The closer you are to the frontier, the more realistic it is to think that you will be able to produce frontier technology. In case this phi would be zero, we will see that the country has no possibility to move away from the previous level of technology. Okay, so with this speed of convergence, we are able to get closer to the frontier, to catch up slowly the frontier technology. Okay, so this is to what the domestic innovator can aim if the innovator is successful in his attempt. So each period, there is in a sector a domestic entrepreneur which is able to attempt this innovation. And the success probability of this attempt is given by this innovation probability function, which is defined as such in order to be between 0 and 1. What is more important is to note that it depends on the investment that is being done in innovation. So this XIT is the investment, R&D investment performed in the sector, which so therefore the probability is increasing with this investment, but it's decreasing with the target. So the higher the target that you are setting, the harder, the less chances you are to be successful. Okay. And as I said before, in the case of physical capital investment, we will continue to put this real rigidity associated with the other types of investments in order to have symmetry and not influence the results for the only reason that we introduced rigidity only for one type of investment. What we are going to do later is to estimate all these parameters and let the data say if it makes sense to have all these rigidities or not. Okay, so as I said before, we are modeling all these adjustment costs functions in exactly the same way. Good. Then once we have the domestics, we have the domestic innovators, we also have a decision process for the multinational firms. We actually started the whole project with an exogenous process, but then we found that it's more interesting to also give some decision power to the multinationals. So the multinationals have a very similar decision process, so they also have a probability of entering this domestic economy. And remember, here we have the difference that the multinationals can bring the frontier technology directly. So we don't have any more an AT target. They bring AT max, the frontier technology. So there is this probability of success for the multinational entry, which depends on the investment that the multinational is making, M, in sector I, and we are associating this with FDI. So the more foreign direct investment that is made, the higher would be the probability of success of this multinational. What we do differently, because we also see we have here this drag from the technological frontier. The higher is the frontier that you are targeting, this will decrease your success probability. What we are doing differently here is to add this shock. While before, in the case of the domestic innovation process, we were not putting a shock, here we are also allowing for this shock to capture any fluctuations that will be due to source or destination country factors. Okay, so whatever may exogenous to our setup that can influence the probability of multinationals entry. And similarly, FDI is subject to this quadratic adjustment cost modeled in the same way. And as I said, we will estimate all these parameters, adjustment cost parameters, that will tell us which should be in, which is stronger, which is not. Good. What the multinational firm has to do is to, well, when it decides to enter, it does this solves this profit maximization problem, And well, it takes the nominal stock market value of this front of firm that has the frontier technology, and considers what will be successful with the success probability that will be a frontier firm in this economy, and accounts for the costs of entry. Okay, it's a standard maximization problem, and what the firm chooses is how much to invest. So it chooses this M that, as I said, we are thinking of as foreign direct investment. Okay, therefore, once we are aggregating, what we will have is that productivity. So once we are putting all together all these possibilities that can be in each sector, what we have is that productivity in each particular sector can be the frontier with probability F. Okay, so these are the success probabilities of multinationals with probability 1 minus F times the probability of innovation. It will be the target productivity, the one of the innovators. And in case none of them is successful, then with probability 1 minus F times 1 minus N, we are left with the level of productivity from the previous period. Okay. Having that in mind, we can look at what's the maximization problem of the domestic innovator. The domestic innovator does take into account that there is this probability of the foreign company to enter the domestic economy. So he has this piece of information in mind when making the decision of innovating. Okay, and takes into account that there is this part of the investment that comes from the government. One minus is what is paid by the household, and the rest is just provided by the government. Okay, so we have this choice of how much to be invested in research and development, and well, we get this first order condition with respect to the investment. It's important to note that multinationals, once they are in a sector, they become a domestic firm. Okay, so they will behave as a domestic firm. Okay, so they are able afterwards to innovate as the others. They can target the intermediate level of technology afterwards. They can also be becoming obsolete. Okay, so multinationals can enter sectors where there was before some multinational company as a leader. Okay, so once we have this identical type of firms in a sector, and having one coming as a leader in the sector, it's obvious that some will become obsolete and get out of the economy. However, once we are aggregating, because all these sectors function independently one for the other, and so they are not influencing each other, we don't have to keep track of the there is no heterogeneity somehow, if I'm making myself clear. So we don't have a distribution. We can apply the law of large numbers, and we can get to an evolution of a discussion in terms of the sectors that are dominated by multinationals. Okay, so this is a way that this model is making the discussion simple, that we don't have to keep track of heterogeneities. Okay, so what we have is that we can observe once we have this, we make this aggregation, that there is a law of motion. So we have an evolution of the mass of sectors that are dominated by multinationals. So then the share of multinationals, better said, in the economy is equal to their number in the previous period plus whatever it's coming new. So it's a probability 1 minus f, those that are being times the ones that are entering, and minus those that are losing their leader in favor of domestic innovators. Okay. So that being said, we can then put together the law of motion for productivity in this economy. Okay, and the productivity in this economy is with probability f. If multinationals are successful in entering the economy, it's the frontier technology plus 1 minus f times the probability of being successful for domestic innovators, times this is the intermediate level of the productivity that is targeted by the domestic innovators, plus 1 minus n. This is the level of productivity from before, being the case when neither the multinationals nor the domestic innovators are successful. Okay. So in the equilibrium, the firm values are proportional to their productivity indexes, and therefore what we can observe is that the average stock value of an incumbent, which is a firm in our economy, equals the dividends that it produces plus its value next period, its stock market value next period, in case it survives. Okay. Now that I'm looking at the time, that I don't lose so much time further on discussing the model, I'm almost done with this. So we are allowing for free trade of the homogeneous final good with the rest of the world. Obviously, this part can be more complicated. We are just allowing the economy to accumulate net foreign assets or liabilities. But as I said, it can be further complicated. The definition of net foreign assets, or the evolution of net foreign assets, is pretty standard. What I would say, it's different to an unusual small open economy model, is that we have this part of the dividends that are going abroad, that are being paid to the owners of multinationals. Okay, we have this Schmidt-Groh and Ribe definition of the domestic real interest rate that equals the steady state interest world interest rate plus a premium. Okay, that's that depends on the net foreign assets share in GDP, their deviation from steady state, for which you are penalized if you are deviating from. Trade balance and current account, well, as I said, they look standard. Again, here for the current account, we have this only new difference coming from the dividends that are paid to foreign owners of the multinationals. And the simple definition that could be used for the part of the R&D investment that is financed by the government, we are using an exogenous process. So we are just saying that the share of domestic R&D fluctuates stochastically around this steady state value. So this is the share of business performed R&D that is financed by the government. Okay, and as defined previously, the government is financing this part of investment in R&D with lump sum taxes T. The shocks you have already seen in the previous equation. So there are these six shocks. We are not putting more, that we are not trying, that we don't want to estimate more parameters than what we have. And we do have six observables. We have this shock to frontier technology, the temporary productivity shock in the production function, shock to the household intertemporal preferences, the marginal efficiency to investment shock, The MNC's entry rate shock, the one I showed you in the multinationals entry probability function. And we have this shock to the R&D government investment subsidy that was introduced on the previous slide. In terms of calibration, so here we were trying to match the data that we have for Hungary. So most of the variables for the calibration, we try to use the data for Hungary for the sample period that we had. And that's where you see the steady state information. When we are talking about the frontier technology growth rate, as I said, we use the information for the United States. So here is where we are. This is the growth rate of TFP in the United States over the period 1995-2019. Okay. What else? So in the case where we didn't have something for Hungarian data, as it was what was pointed out when we were talking about the utility function. So we were trying to use that it is this parameter that determines the elasticity of labor supply, which would give us a sort of fresh elasticity around one, or this sigma that determines, well, given the specific utility function, it gives the intertemporal elasticity of substitution. We gave a value of two. So these were calibration that are in line with the related literature. But it's also something we had to do in order to not have to estimate all those parameters as Mihai indicated. So it would have been a too big challenge for our model, given the data availability to do. Okay, I won't spend more time on that, given the time constraint. What the data that we are using, and here was a second complication, was that we don't have only quarterly data, and our model is built at quarterly frequency. So we use, as I said, for frontier technology, we use the quarterly growth rate of USTFP, non-adjusted capacity utilization. This is from John Fernald's website. We have from Eurostat most data for Hungary. So we have the quarterly GDP growth rate from Eurostat, consumption growth rate, investment growth rate. We have the annual share of the business performed R&D that is financed by the government only at annual frequency. And similarly, the growth rate of Hungarian TFP, which we obtained from the conference board, also at annual frequency. The advantage of performing the estimation in Diner is that we could do this estimation with missed frequency data, given that Diner applies a common filter to create information for your missing data points. We also constructed, so interpolated series, and there were not considerable differences in our results. So we then took confidence in the Diner approach. So what we further estimate were the parameters that define the processes for the shock processes, standard deviation and autocorrelation coefficients, and those parameters that we didn't have information to give them a value, for which we chose to use the estimation such that we use the data to tell us what their value should be in this particular case. We had two Markov chains of 600,000 draws. We dropped half of them, and then we were sampling from 100,000 such uniformly, such that we would get the mean values and their credible sets. I don't know if there's anyone interested in seeing all these results. If you are, you can let me know What I want to point out is some particular values that I think are relevant. So what the estimation gave us as a result is that real rigidity seemed to be important in our model. Almost all of them were far from zero, with the exception of FDI adjustment costs. So among them, we had the highest value for the adjustment for the elasticity of capital investment adjustment cost, which was had a mean of 6.2. Then we had for the R&D investment adjustment cost a value of 4.4 and almost zero for FDI adjustment costs, which we found realistic as a result, as we were expecting capital investment to have a relatively low variability compared to R&D investment, and especially to FDI. And we know that, FDI inflows are more volatile than the others. And, this is reassuring also because we didn't have FDI as observable. Okay?
Just a quick question here. Yeah. Did you compare the moments generating, like standard deviation of your investment series in the model compared with what you see in the data?
We did. So
because my idea is, for example, if you do this for Romania, and we did this with our DSG model, mm-hmm. due to the very volatile nature of investment of gross fixed capital formation, the investment adjustment costs are extremely low, and okay. this happens only if you estimate the model using these endogenous priors, a la Cristiano Traban Valentin, the like sequential learning stuff, where you take into account the variability in the data. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, for example, also the habit formation parameter. Mm-hmm. If you estimate it classical Bayesian stuff, you get pretty high, but okay. then your variability of consumption in the model and in the data in the model is much lower than what you have in the data. And if you do this sequential learning endogenous priors procedure, then you get a much lower posterior mean for the habit formation and for the mm-hmm. investment adjustment cost. But the standard deviation of the model and the data you observe are much, much closer.
Okay, so for us, they are not perfectly matching, but they are not very far. So doing this model fitting, I have it in the paper. I don't have it in the presentation, though, to my shame. I mean, they should have it. But they are not very far off. We were not worrying that much of the fact that they are not matching perfectly, because we knew that, we don't have so many observations, and we are trying to match some things for which we are not putting data in the model.
But that's the idea, what you have, I mean, behind also, even more behind the sequential learning stuff, that it fits.
Yeah,
it's much better for the small samples.
Mm-hmm. No, it's a great suggestion, and I will take it into account. We haven't done that. It's pure classical, so maybe we should try to do also the sequential approach. I haven't done it so far.
It's in Diner. You can just.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thanks a lot. No, we will try to do it, and it's a good point. So excellent point. Thanks for that. Well taken, because we got this, and we were happy with the. How to say, with their ranking, you know, that it was higher for capital than for R&D, than for FDI adjustment, because we found this in the direction of what we would expect. And lastly, as I said, what we had is this estimation of the chi parameter, which is pointing us in the direction of KPR preferences. Okay, I have very few minutes left, so I will try to go very quickly through the results. What we obtained was, this is in terms of impulse responses to multinationals and entry shock, so to the probability of entry shock. And what we observe, of course, once we have this shock, we have an increase in the probability of multinationals entry. And we are plotting for 120 quarters, so this is over 30 years, and we see that for many variables, we are not converging fast towards the steady state, even though the shock is not persistent. Okay, so and this comes from the mechanism of the model, the endogenous growth part. But what we have is that multinationals entry shock is leading to an increase in average productivity in the detriment of domestic firms. So domestic firms are reducing their investment, so there is less innovation, this is a reduction in domestic innovation following a multinational entry shock. However, given that the multinationals are bringing frontier technology, which leads to an increase in average productivity, we have more output, and also we have more some more capital investment, which is accentuating the effects. So we see also more capital, and some positive effect in terms of consumption, but not as much as we would have expected from looking at output. And we were trying for some time to figure out which are the mechanisms that are at play in here. And what we have realized is that there are, well, lots of things happening in here. One thing is that we have a part of the dividends now, a bigger part of the dividends going abroad, so less resources for the domestic consumers who were owners of the domestic firms. So a big part of them became obsolete. And also there is a stronger investment in capital. So, and this is something that goes in line to what empirics were showing, that when there are capital inflows, there is an increase in investment and not much in consumption. So this goes in line with what empirics are finding. In terms of R&D, what we had obtained in when there is a subsidy shock was that even though the probability of innovation is increasing, what we have is that productivity drops, and this is because multinationals are not attracted anymore by this policy. We also have higher taxes on the household. So there is less capital investment. What we do have is a bit more in terms of consumption, mostly in the medium run when there is the taxes are being reduced because we have a temporary increase in R&D subsidy. And this comes from the fact that there is less foreign competition, so more dividends coming from the incumbents towards the consumers. I have very few minutes, so I wanted to show you something that we find interesting in that with the green light here in the historical decomposition for the growth rate of the of observed output, the strong green bars are the contributions of multinationals' entry. And we observed that they match pretty well periods of capital inflows and political periods. In Hungary, we have this period, Hungary, well, this is storytelling, but Hungary was one of the first countries that that opened, and they had more measures taken even prior to 1990. So they were one of the countries in the group that received most FDI, had strong privatization very early at the beginning of the 90s. And for this reason, from 1995, when many of the others started to attract FDI, they experienced a reduction, and some of the others in the group were aggressively targeting, trying to attract multinationals. So we don't have a very big contribution. It's still considerable, but it's not very big in the period prior to the to their accession to the European Union. But once a big part of the group entered the European Union, they had to align the policies for multinational targeting. So we see an increase, well, and also access to the European market, so free movements and so on and so forth. So we have a stronger contribution of MNCs entries to output growth. I think we had the peak being a contribution of 1 percentage point to GDP growth in 2006. However, we see also a strong negative contribution in the Great Recession. And this is an interesting result because in general, well, we know that there was the diffusion, the spread of the Great Recession all over Europe, of course, but they have already this from the onset of the crisis. And in the particular case of Hungary, the US is the main foreign non-EU investor. So we observe the very strong effect of the reduction in multinationals entry. Okay, so we have, I think the strongest effect was about 2.2 percentage points attributed from the growth rate of dampening of output attributed to multinationals entry, so to their negative effect. So what we can see once in this plot, what we did was to actually take out the contribution of the multinationals entry shock and see how the series would look like if we wouldn't have this contribution, just to see by how much it contributes and how it would have looked otherwise. And what we see is exactly what has been also discussed heavily in the media is this amplification of the cycle. We see that, so the green line in here is what would have otherwise be the counterfactual without the MNC entry shock. So we see that in boom periods, without the shock, we would have had lower output growth. But in the Great Recession here, we would have had a less reduction in GDP growth. And more interesting, what we found in this graph is the recovery. So without the MNC entry shock, it seems that output growth would have went into positive territory much earlier than it actually did, about 1 year earlier than it did in reality. I am running out of time, so I am wrapping up by saying what you have seen so in this paper. So we have introduced the Schumpeterian creative destruction model in a non-frontier small open economy DSGE model. We used it to analyze the interplay between MNC's entry and domestic R&D in driving endogenous productivity. And we applied this model to Hungarian data to make our quantitative analysis. Our estimated model is indicating that MNC's entry are both boon and ban, and they proved to be like that in this case of Hungary throughout the period we are looking at. On the positive side, it led to it had contributed positively to growth in this period, even though what our model was indicating, it has discouraged domestic innovation. On the downside, it had led to business cycle amplifications. What we think from this is that from our model, this point is that it is empirically plausible from what it has delivered, and we find it as a good starting point to analyze MNC's entries effect on both the business cycle and the medium to long run fluctuations in emerging markets. And obviously there are important extensions that can be made, as already pointed out in terms of improving the accuracy of the model and making it more realistic by introducing at least nominal rigidities and trade and things like that that can be further done. So thank you. I am almost on time. If there are further questions, I am available.
Thank you, Maria. Întrebări? Pot fi adresate și în română, nu e nicio.
Nu știu cât mă pricep eu să răspund în română.
Pot răspunde în engleză.
Dacă nu, la Hermes.
Mai am eu o întrebare. Da.
Sigur.
În ce măsură șocul ăsta de... Adică mie, când ți-am văzut graficul pe care l-ai arătat și mi-ai descris cum a fi arătat PIB-ul, presupun, creșterea PIB-ului relativ, dacă nu s-ar fi manifestat șocul ăsta. Uh-huh. Știind ce, nu știu, ce am obținut noi, în ce măsură șocul ăsta de intrare de multinaționale nu e o echivalență între el și între un sovereign risk premium shock pe care tu nu l-ai acolo? Nu?
Și ar trebui să fac să-l introduc?
Dacă îl introduci, unul dintre ele nu o să mai fie, din punctul meu de vedere, iarăși, identificabil, adică depinzând de ce observabil le pui. Mă gândesc că e echivalent, în sensul că... nu știu, ți intră multinaționalele, îți crește capacitatea, poate ai, ok, ai și inflow-uri, ai apreciere, ai îmbunătățire de primă de risc, deci cumva ai șocuri pozitive care îți duc prima de risc mai jos și ulterior când ai criză, ai niște șocuri foarte negative care te apar. Nu știu, cam, cred că Cristi poate să confirme, cam așa arată și la noi dacă dăm la o parte. Adică un șoc suveran, de prima de risc suveran, are aceleași efecte. Îți amplifică boom-ul și îți amplifică și bust-ul. Deci îți mărește volatilitatea business cycle. Și mă gândesc că s-ar putea să fie echivalente ca rezultate cele două.
Am înțeles. Da, poate că ar fi o idee să încerc să-l pun...
Poți să-l pui în modul în care
da,
ai domestic interest rate acolo.
Da. Și a, să pun un real interest rate, ceva să văd dacă pot să creez. Cred că aveam creat la un moment dat observabilă, dar n-am mai pus-o ca să pot să-l identific. Și să văd ce se întâmplă. Da, e... Știi cum e, că atunci când pui chestii în model, nu știu unde ajungi, am mai pus, am mai scos, am mai vrei să rămână și simpluț, să nu mai ajungi, să nu-ți dai seama de unde, ce se întâmplă în totalitate, dar întotdeauna mai sunt chestii interesante de adăugat. Mi se pare foarte dificil să-ți dai seama unde e suficient. Să te oprești. Dar asta eu cu șocul ăsta nu am lucrat în model până acum. A fost într-o versiune la un moment dat, dar într-o versiune calibrată. Și apoi am încercat să lăsăm cât mai puține șocuri, câte observabile aveam și cele care mi se păreau nouă mai importante. Sunt la care chiar nu poți să renunți, că alea sunt... cheie. Dar da, asta l-am putea adăuga și să vedem ce se întâmplă. Speranța e să nu ni-l ia de tot pe ăsta.
Da, e asta.
Dar da, mersi de sugestie. Nu știu și cealaltă legată de estimare. O văzusem ca idee, n-am folosit-o niciodată pe aia sequential. Și... dacă am văzut că asta a funcționat, am zis ok, se mișcă lucrurile în estimare, pentru că inițial era, modelul a fost calibrat. L-am trimis la un jurnal și au cerut estimare. Must. Problema era că nu știi, una e la US, alta e pentru Ungaria. Nu știi cum să-ți calibrezi șocurile acolo, ce să pui la standard deviation și la autocorrelation. Habar n-am ce pot fi. Și atunci a început procedura de estimare, dar na, e dificilă, ținând cont că nu, voi știți mai bine cum e cu datele disponibile pentru țările din zonă. Doar să vedem. Să sperăm că nu schimbă mare lucru dacă mai adăugăm șocul ăla. Iar cu estimarea chiar nu știu, chiar sunt curioasă, adică chiar vreau să încerc. Dar e ușor de implementat?
Da, da, e doar opțiune endogenous price în comanda de estimate.
Ok. Ok. Știu că am văzut, o știu și la, dar din mai multe lucrări. Dacă nu, chiar o preda și Larry Cristiano la Gherte. O să încerc.
Alte întrebări? Depășit puțin timpul? Dacă nu mai sunt, mulțumim mult încă o dată, Maria.
Și eu vă mulțumesc.
Și ne mai revedem, poate, nu știu, un visiting la bancă la un moment dat, ține legătura. Dacă ai nevoie de date pentru România și putem ajuta eu și colegii mei cu drag.
Mulțumesc mult și da, cu siguranță. Oricum, cu siguranță e Hermas-ul. Da. Și cu mare drag, da, aș veni și la bancă. Îmi spuneți când aveți visiting-uri. Da. Bine,
mulțumim mult.
Mulțumim, la revedere.
La revedere.